church.
Good morning.
Oh, that's bad. Good morning, church. Good, good. Man, the sun's shining outside. We're excited to be here today. It's a great day. We're going to worship God. And we're just so happy that you've come to join us, especially if you're visiting with us. Hope you grabbed a handout. I want to remind everyone that today, this afternoon, is our area-wide for our youth. That things will get cranking up around 3:30 here with them, and worship is at 4:30, and we'd love for you to come and be a part of that. Okay, it's not just youth only; it's for the church to come. So feel free to come at 4:30, join in. The singing will be wonderful with over 200 plus young people in here, and you joining them will really help. And so we want to invite you to come back this afternoon at 4:30 and join us for that time of worship with the area-wide youth. A lot of other things taking place and going on. They're all listed there in the handout, so be aware of those things and be involved in those things and be praying about those things, that God will bless us in those and we'll multiply through our efforts of these activities and stuff that is going on here. But we're really excited to be here to praise God today. And I hope that you are. I hope you're prepared for that and are ready to lift your voices up to Him. So let's be standing. Bo will be leading us.
He took my burdens all the way up to the
God.
Father, our God in heaven, we're so grateful to you for all things. As humans, Father, it's easy to worship and praise you on such a beautiful spring day, to see the sunshine and enjoy the things that we like in this life. But our prayer, Father, is that you would be with us each and every day. When there are storms in our life, physically or emotionally or spiritually, we know that you're there. And we pray, Father, that we would look to you for the strength and the guidance that we need. Father, we're grateful for everything that you give us. Your word says you are the giver of all good and perfect gifts. And we're thankful, Father. Help us to never take them for granted and use the things that you give us that we might bring glory and honor to your name, that we might serve you by serving your people world over. And Father, if those things stand between us and thee and our spiritual relationship, our prayer is, Father, that you would take them from us. Help us to realize how truly blessed we are on the spiritual realm, that you have prepared for us an opportunity to be with you forever. Father, in a place where there's no pain, no suffering, Father, that we would be perfect and that we would be with you and your Son, our Savior. We're so thankful for him who gave his life that brings us these blessings. It gives us an opportunity to be your children, to be a part of your family. Father, we do pray for those of our number that are struggling with physical affliction, pain, suffering, and sickness, that you would bless them, Father. But bless us all, Father, not only physically, but bless us spiritually, that we might draw closer to you and more like your Son. Above all, we thank you for him who makes it all possible. And our prayer is, Father, that you continue to grow us and transform us into the likeness of him, that the world may see him living through us, that we might shine his light and show his love in all that we do. It's in his precious name we pray. Amen.
Oh, Master, let me walk with thee in holy paths of service free. Tell me thy secret, help me bear the strain of toil, the friend.
This morning we have an opportunity at this time in our giving to share and to just be reminded of all the goodness of God and how abundant He is towards us. But I was thinking of something this week that I need to work on a little bit more. We look at this part of our worship as our time of giving. But too often, I believe that we confine our giving to what we do on Sunday morning. It should be the beginning of it. And I want to challenge you this morning, as I challenge myself, to every day this week to ask God to open our eyes, open our hearts to ways that we can give and help and share that day. God will put opportunities before us. He will use us for His glory. And I know that He will bless us so that we have even more resources to share and give to others as they have need. Let's give God thanks as we pray together. Our Father, You're such an abundant God who gives us so much more than we need. And we just pray, Father, this morning that as we reflect back on the abundance of Your riches that You've showered on us, that You will help us to have cheerful hearts, open hearts, giving hearts that want to share with others that have need, to share with our resources to help the work of this congregation. And Father, most of all, that everything that we do will bring honor, glory, and praise to You for being the great, good, and abundant God that You are. It's through Jesus we pray. Amen.
Jesus was by Him betrayed, the fire sent good. Today's scripture reading comes from John 15, 11 through 14. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you.
Amen.
Be seated, please.
Today we continue on in our series that we're looking at the important question of what does God want from each of us? And there's a lot of good answers to that question. We've kind of narrowed it down to four. We began by talking about the first thing that God wants is our faith. God says, believe me. And last week we talked about the fact that God wants us to love him. In fact, Jesus said, here's the greatest command, to love God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. And God is love, and what God wants most from all of us is for us to love him back. Today we look at the third thing that God wants, and that is God wants us to obey him. God says, I want your faith, I want your love, and I want you to obey me. For over 3 years, Jesus declared his love for his disciples. He let them know in no uncertain terms, I love you. He washed their feet. He healed their relatives. He protected them from danger. He spoke to them truths that they had never heard before. He eventually died for each one of them on a cross. There was no doubt about Jesus' love for his disciples. But in John 14, he kind of does a 180. He says, if you love me, then keep my commandments. In other words, Jesus said, if you love me, then obey me. Obedience is actually the central theme throughout all the Bible. God placed a very high premium upon obedience. Let's be honest, obedience is not always easy. And here's why. We don't like to be told what to do, when to do it, or how to do it. And Jesus comes along and he says, true experience of God will always result in obedience of God. We're obedient to God's commands, and when we are, we come in alignment with what God created us to be. God wants us to obey, and it's not because he's on some power trip. It's because he knows what's best for each of us. Now, today we're going to be in 1 John chapter 2. You want to open your Bibles there, you can follow along with us on the screens. And we're going to use this text to answer a question of why God wants me to obey him. And the first reason is this: it proves our salvation. In verse 3 of 1 John 2 says, and by this we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. Now remember, John told us back in his gospel that if you love Jesus, then keep his commandments. Now he tells us that we can know God, and here's how we know that we know God: by obedience. A lot of people know God in terms of accepting the facts by God. And John is telling us that we can know God not just in our heads, but also in our hearts. Now, don't misunderstand what John is saying here. He's not saying that if you want to be saved, if you want to know God as your Savior, if you want to, you know, receive grace, then all you have to do is just obey all the rules. I don't think that's what he's saying. He's saying that if you really want to know God, then that the way that is manifest is through obedience. Just obey him. He's not teaching salvation is conditional to obedience. He's teaching that salvation is evidenced by our obedience. Over in Hosea chapter 4, the Bible says this: "Hear the word of the Lord, O children of Israel, for the Lord has a controversy with the inhabitants of the land. There is no faithfulness or steadfast love and no knowledge of God in the land. They're swearing, lying, murdering, stealing, committing adultery. They're breaking all bounds, and bloodshed follows bloodshed." And what the prophet is pointing out here is this: you cannot have a knowledge of God and there be a persistence of sin in your life. Now, I realize that we all sin. I get that. That's not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is those areas of our life where we know that disobedience exists and we really don't care. We don't want to do anything about it. And here's the deal. There are too many Christians that have set aside the obligations of Christianity while still trying to hold on to the privileges of Christianity. And what we end up doing is this: we end up treating Christianity like the drive-thru. When we go through the drive-thru, we say, what? I'll take one of these, and I'd like a little of that, and I don't want any of this, and hold this, and give me that. And John is telling us that partial obedience is really disobedience. Now, I got to be honest with you this morning. I cannot envision ever a time in my life where I would have practiced partial obedience with my dad. I mean, I can't imagine my dad ever telling me to do something and me looking at him and saying, you know, I think I'll pass on that one. I would have passed all right. I'd have passed away. You see, the problem with selective obedience is we just pick the things we like, and the things that we don't like, we don't do those. And if we would never consider selective obedience with our earthly fathers, then why in the world would we ever consider it with our heavenly Father? And so John tells us, obey when it's inconvenient, obey when it doesn't make sense, obey when it's costly. Here's what God wants: obey me. The second thing, and second reason, rather, why God wants us to obey him is this: it transforms our lives. God's desire for every one of us is to be like his son. But here's the deal: he will not force that on you. If we are passive in our relationship with him, we can never expect to grow. What obedience is an invitation to allow God to come into our life. Look at verse 4. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. If we claim to know God, and yet our life has never been changed by knowing God, then maybe that's a sure indication that we really don't know God. When we give God permission to take control of our life, we're signing up for an adventure. And obedience is the key to unlocking that adventure. Transformation for the believer and our character, it's evidenced by responding to the demands of God just like Jesus did. John 14, whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Again, it doesn't imply that obedience is always easy. Obedience wasn't easy for Jesus. You remember what happened in the garden? The night before the cross? What is Jesus doing? Jesus is agonizing. Jesus is struggling with obedience because obedience for Jesus meant dying on a cross. But yet Paul would tell us in Philippians 2, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Without his obedience, the world would have been lost. Without our obedience, the church is nothing more than just another social club. What is it that God wants? Obey me. And now the third thing is this. It shows our love. In verse 5, he said, "But whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in him." John broadens the idea of obey the commands to keep his word. He appears to be saying that to keep his word is a clear indication that God's love has done its work in us. There's this unbreakable relationship between love and obedience. They're joined at the hip. Love is the motive for obedience, and obedience is the measure of love. And God wants us to love him before we obey him, and he wants us to obey him because we love him. And in this text, John is addressing motive. And there's really three emotions that become a motivator for all of us. The first level is that of fear. Fear is an incredibly effective motivator, but it is a terrible motivator. To use fear to motivate is saying, I have to do this or this will happen. A lot of abusive children obey their parents. It's not because of love or care. It's because they fear physical harm. The second level of motivation is that of duty. A Gallup survey indicated that 70% of people do not like their jobs. I don't know if that's true or not. I love my job. But I don't know if it's true or not, if 70% of people don't like their job. But then they were asked the question, well, why do you keep going to work? And the answer was this, out of a sense of duty, out of a sense of obligation. A lot of people do a lot of things and are motivated merely out of obligation. A lot of people obey out of a sense of duty, a sense of obligation. But that third motivator and the highest and the most satisfying motivator is love. Fear says, I have to do this. Duty says, I need to do this. And love says, I want to do this. And when you reach the point that you comprehend fully what Jesus did for you on the cross, when you understand grace, when you grasp the depth of God's love for you, our response is to love and obey him no matter what. If we love God, then we'll keep his commandments. And if we keep his commandments, we evidence that love that we have for him. Here's what God wants. Obey me. And finally, it characterizes our walk. Back here in 1 John 2 and verse 1, John called Jesus the righteous one. And then down here in verses 5 and 6, he says, but whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. Here's the question for all of us. Do people know that we're Christians by the way we walk? Are people able to understand that by observing us? Does our walk line up with our talk? Dietrich Bonhoeffer described grace without discipleship as being the ability to parrot the words of Christ while living like the rest of the world. Folks, we cannot show up, sing a few songs, say a few prayers, eat the cracker and drink the juice, walk out the door and shed the yoke of Christ on the way to the car. We have to live this. We have to live Christ. We have to be a witness to the world, the love of Christ. We're to make a difference. We're to reflect Christ, and we're to get up the next morning, and we're to do it all over again. And there is a difference in walking with Jesus and walking like Jesus. And the difference is manifest in obedience. Paul would say in Ephesians, "I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling which you've been called, with all humility and gentleness and patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace." The calling which you are called is to walk like Jesus. And here's what that looks like: in humility, in gentleness, in patience, in love, and in peace. And we can't walk like Jesus unless we obey like Jesus. Here's what God wants. Obey me. You know, I suspect, and I have no way of knowing this, but I suspect when some people see Jesus for the first time, when he comes back, maybe the first thought that might run through their mind is this: I wish I'd have loved and obeyed him more. I don't know. Maybe that'll happen. Roger Staubach was the famous quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys. He led them to a world championship in 1971. Staubach said he really struggled as a quarterback because he couldn't call his own plays. Tom Landry was a legendary coach of the Cowboys and was known as a genius at play calling. Staubach could change the play, but only in the case of an emergency. And if he changed the play, it had better work. But Staubach went on to say, you know what? When I finally learned obedience, there was harmony, fulfillment, and victory. Believing is to know Jesus. And to know Jesus is to love Jesus. And to love Jesus is to obey Jesus. Maybe today you're ready to do that. You're ready to submit your life to him. There could be someone here who's ready to confess their faith in him and be baptized. Or maybe you're ready to, like Staubach, realize and come to terms with obedience. That's where you find fulfillment. That's where you find joy, peace, and ultimately, victory. Here's what God wants. Obey me. While you decide, let's stand and sing.
My stubborn will, let my hands end in. I would be thine and thine.
Sweet will of God, still for me.
this song before we take the Lord's Supper. You were despised, you were rejected, Lord, to satisfy.
This morning, I'm going to read the words to a song that we frequently sing. I believe sometimes when we sing a song, and this is one of my favorite songs, we enjoy the words, and we sometimes, and very rightfully, enjoy the melody and rhythm of the song because of the joy and experience, the emotional thing that it does for us. But I want us to read these, I want to read these words today and help you maybe to think of these words in a little different light since we're not singing them. And maybe that'll help us to focus more on what Christ has done for us and why we're joining together in this communion. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love and what depths of peace when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone who took on flesh, fullness of God and helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world, by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ, I'll stand. Let's give thanks together. Lord God, we focus our attention now on Jesus, what he's done for us. And we, this morning, Father, as a group of believers, sharing in this bread together as we remember his body, help us to remember that it's only in Christ where we find our hope. It's only in Christ where we find our strength. It's only in Christ where we find our forgiveness and our redemption. Help us to remember that more fully as we share in this bread together. It's in the name of Christ that we ask this and pray. Amen. Lord, we remember the body of Jesus on the cross, and in our mind's eye, we can see his suffering, his pain, and we can see the blood that was shed and poured out for us. As we drink this cup together, help our minds to be attentive to the blood of Jesus. To realize that it's only through his blood that our sins can be forgiven and washed away, and that we can be made pure and holy and declared righteous because of what Jesus has done for us. It's in him we pray. Amen.
Let's stand as we sing this song, please.
We will see the Holy City come descending like a bride, with the Lamb of glory seated on his throne. A new earth and a new heaven, where the gates open wide, when the King of Zion comes to claim his
Father, we're so thankful to have been here this morning, thankful to know that you're in our presence. Father, as we gather together, let us always focus on you. Let us always have our heart open to worship you. And Father, as we've learned this morning, help us to understand obedience and what it means in our lives and what it demonstrates to you. Help us as we leave here to demonstrate that obedience to all those that we come in contact with, and that we do so in faith and love, as we've already talked about the last 2 weeks. Father, be with us as we depart. Guide us in all that we do and use us in your kingdom. We pray all these things through your Son's name, and all the church says.